and classical architecture, I think, many times gets a very, it gets a bum rap in a way because people think it's easy. It's very difficult to execute classical architecture well. And there's hundreds of examples all over the United States of bad, where people have tried to do it very poorly. And that's the true beauty in this building is such an underlying force that people just naturally relate to, I think, from a very human place, from a very human scale that makes it special for everyone who comes in.
You speak about bad classes. I keep a folder of such images for my students to feel inspired and how far they've come, even in just their first year of design studio. So yes, it is not always easy, as any architecture student will tell you, to necessarily design a good classical building. Mm. We've spoken a good bit today already about the durability of the classical language, durability of community, and therefore the importance of the civic within that. Curious in what ways, if there are any specific examples, how physical durability was addressed in this building, the siting, any sort of materials or physical construction that you might want to highlight, or if it's really just an overall overarching theme for this particular building?
Buildings like this are heavily used, and one of the things that we owe our clients is to make sure that maintenance costs are as low as possible. The mayor was extraordinarily diligent in making sure this building's cladding was Indiana limestone, no more durable material imaginable. And classicism obviously lends itself to a classical building. Likewise, if you look at the floors are all various forms of hard stone within the heavy trafficked areas. The classical metier does, in terms of its material uses, promote a low maintenance building. And one of the things that any community wants to do is spend as little money as possible on an ongoing basis to keep the building running and spend as much of their resources as possible on what goes on stage. And I think we were very concerned about making sure that we gave the mayor and a building that was possible to maintain. The mayor was equally diligent in making sure that the resources were available to spend the money where it needed to be spent to make sure this building was a fairly low maintenance building.
Anybody else have anything they'd like to throw in there?
Well, as to the question about materials, in addition to steel, it's really a room within a room for acoustical purposes, and 12-inch thick concrete blocks, and I watched it going up, and the holes that are normal in concrete blocks were filled with concrete from a standpoint. So this building is very solid. There's not really much in it to burn or be destroyed. We had to get a type of tile roof that would work in a freeze-thaw cycle. And there was a Cincinnati company, isn't it? So it's not quite an Indiana product, but very close, right across the border. We wanted to use local materials as much as we could, and so the Indiana limestone was important to me. It was still hand done by craftsmen, pneumatic tools, the fluting on the columns, and other designs in the on the outside, on the exterior of the building. But there's better people than me to talk about what the building's made of.
Well, I'd probably just add that the one thing you learn in a large project like this is it literally takes hundreds, if not thousands, of people to do their job very well to pull something like this off. And particularly in the construction trades, this harkens back to the traditional trades. I mean, plaster and stone cutting and things that have been done for thousands of years and really are a dying art. I mean, one of the things we've seen is there's just not, if you just go through the stonemasons plant or if you watch the plasters, there's not a lot of young people that are doing those trades, and that's probably one of the things that we'd love to see a little more emphasis as they talk about education now and kids choosing paths. There's a wonderful path that could be chosen there for a lot of young workers that would, I think, allow us to keep doing architecture like this for a number of years. There's going to be a point where it's going to be very difficult to get a project like this done.
Absolutely. That's something that many of us face. I know there's a wonderful school in Charleston that's trying to alleviate some of that, and there's certainly folks in England and other communities, but But the more the better, because if we have more opportunity for craftsmen to work and more craftsmen to use, we can all make it a more affordable and more ubiquitous thing.
I think at one point the schedule for facilities is driven by the vacation schedule of the plasterers. There's so few.
The two guys you could find. Right?
Yeah, never knew that. Those,
we had to drive them to and from work every day to make sure they got it.
Certainly, it's a process like this is a huge collaboration with all the craftsmen and all of the manufacturers and tradesmen that are on the site. But it's also a huge collaboration throughout the design process, too. Sometimes we like to think of ourselves as solo practitioners, but that's never the case. It's never a solo act. And so I'd be curious to know about the challenges and great opportunities that you might have found in this as we always find a greater whole than the sum of its parts at the end of a project like this. How would you describe the collaborative process in this instance, and were there any kind of fun stories that came up along the way that you'd like to share?
No.
David, you're shortening this forum.
We all loved each other. It was all wonderful. It was bliss.
Not have been working with architects. I don't know.
Actually, things I thought did go very smoothly, and one of the things that happens, I guess, is in my opinion, is good work comes from discussion and discourse. It's just like a political system. If everyone agrees, it's not you don't get as good a product. And the you want to say the creative tension between all the different pushing and pulling of mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, and duct sizes, and then all at the time, and that's what really makes a classical building like this difficult to maintain the richness of it and the right proportions is, again, a modern building, we'll raise the ceiling 2 feet, or we'll lower the ceiling 2 feet, or whatever. You don't do that in this type of building. It's very rigidly proportioned, very rigidly designed by David's office, so it is a challenge sometimes to meet all the different goals of all the different parties. Everyone's trying to do a good job, but I think that's where the good design comes from, is from that discourse. If everyone agrees, you don't need some of them.
I think the most important thing, actually, in doing this building was everybody bought into the idea. This building is an incredibly rigorous building. All of the dimensions on this building match around a center point. And everybody had to buy into the idea that doing as rigorous a piece of architecture as this is was worth doing. If any of the people participating and said, oh, you know, you can move this facade 2 feet that way and it will make my life much easier, then this building wouldn't be what it is today. But everybody bought into the notion. Everybody was as excited as my office was about the notion of creating this rigorous a building. And I think that's what made it possible. Everybody thought this was a marvelous undertaking and one worth working very hard to pull off. And I think everybody did.
I know that Michael Feinstein and Steve Libman had hoped to join us this afternoon, and unfortunately there was a lot in the schedule this weekend, so we don't get to be graced with their presence, but perhaps some of you might touch on this as well. This venue is located in a smaller community than a lot of fantastic facilities for the performing arts around the world. Curious about how you see this venue bringing in world-class performers to Indiana that might not otherwise come to some of these smaller markets.
Well, let me start with that question. It's important to recognize that, I think, first of all, that this building is a concert hall and not a theater. Tremendous amount of confusion in the United States about that, because in this country we have so few purpose-built concert halls. And let me just briefly try to explain the differences for, I'm sure most of you know, but you do it anyway. A concert hall does not have fly space to fly the scenery up and down in. It does not have that proscenium arch. It does not have the wings off to the side that the theater has for the actors and actresses to wait to go on stage. The rake or rise of the seats as you go back into that shoebox is a very shallow rise, because a steep rise impacts the sound. Damien can tell you a lot more about why that is. You notice the balconies do not come very far out from the walls, maybe 3 or 4 levels of seats, because we don't want sound to get trapped under those balconies and not reverberate properly. And so what we have designed is a concert hall. Indianapolis metro area has three, four really good theaters, including a great opera theater 6 miles south of us at Butler University, Clues Hall, Morrell Theater, downtown Indianapolis, Indiana Repertory Theater. It has several good theaters. So what we were doing was trying to fill a missing niche in this regional basket of amenities. Now, as we look nationally at how many concert halls are there in suburban settings, it gets very interesting. There are only really two other purpose-built concert halls in suburbs or in cities. One is Strathmore, and it's owned by the Baltimore Symphony, roughly north of Bethesda, roughly halfway between Baltimore and Washington, D.C. Of course, Washington, D.C., one of the venues in the Kennedy Center is our concert hall. And then the other suburban concert hall that I'm aware of is Orange County, California. All the others tend to be in downtown areas. There's not a lot of small theaters in cities our size and so on, but we're not aware of any other city our size in the country that has built a concert hall. But of course, our market niche is just not Carmel. Our market niche is meant to be central Indiana, and really, even, you know, Indiana's a narrow state from east to west, and we see folks from Cincinnati and Chicago and Louisville and other cities in this Midwestern region coming here because we truly believe that this quality of hall will attract the best performers. They'll want to perform here. And we're seeing some of that already, and Michael's seeing it, and, you know, talking about the hall in New York and LA. And we're seeing a tremendous amount of interest from the world's best known and artistically some of the best people in the world.
My answer is going to be far less intellectual than the mayor's. Musicians are like golfers. You wouldn't expect most people would want to go to Georgia to go play golf. And yet, Sea Island has one of the most popular golf courses. Augusta is probably the most desirable course to be played anywhere in the United States. And yet, every great golfer wants to play there. I learned about this in Bass Hall. Musicians, just like golfers, want to play Augusta. Musicians want to play every great hall. And the advantage of building a great hall is that people want to come play there, as the mayor says. And if you think of great musicians in light of being similar to golfers, wanting to play the hard courses, the difficult courses, the beautiful courses, the different courses, halls attract musicians. It's one of the things that amazed me about Bass. The number of people who want to go play at Bass Hall absolutely astounds me. But people want to go play the room. They like the room. And we believe that this is going to be a room that people want to play.
Well, I'm so happy that you were attending Todd Brooks' class at RPI all these years. Because you answered all the acoustic questions. But,
did I get them right?
You did, yes. Oh, thank you. The room and the building and the staff all play a big part in what draws artists to come and return again. It's how they're received by the community, how they have an opportunity to perform in a space that they feel is intimate, and Carmel made all the right choices about how to do that from the start. They chose a small seat count, which was the right number for not only the community to sell tickets and always have that sense of excitement and sold out capacity, but also artists just are so much happier coming to a room of this size and performing and being able to connect with their audience in a way that starts to get very difficult when you get to 2,000 or 2,200 seats and larger. And there's no reason why an artist wouldn't want to come here and then return again after having been here. And I'm also very pleased to say that a lot of the artists who are not the classical artists who've been here and are performing with amplified performances are also very happy, which is something that's very often not the case in the concert hall. And a lot of that, again, goes to the good planning of the mayor, the wonderful order of architecture here, which lends itself well to acoustics and the flexibility of the space and staff.
All right. Getting back a little bit to the idea of a smaller community or a more central community, curious about Your thoughts on, is it easier to get a design such as this built in a community of this scale or location than it might be in a coastal big city? I know as a lifetime Midwesterner, in some circles, the Midwest is sometimes falsely seen as second tier or following, and here you're really taking a leadership role, both in terms of urban design, looking at the new urbanist concept, going back to traditional city planning ideas, but also in terms of the civic aesthetic of this building. And curious about your thoughts on the big city versus the scale community.